Hi, I'm Melissa Stockwell. I am a three-time Paralympian, a wounded veteran, a mom, an inspirational speaker, and here is an inside look at my story.
We have a very special guest with us today, and I am truly, truly honored to welcome her to the stage.
An Army officer turned Paralympian in 2004, Melissa Stockwell.
She has turned herself into a world champion athlete.
So 19 years ago today, on April 13th of 2004, I woke up that morning in Iraq with both of my legs, and I went to sleep that night with just one of them. We go under this bridge and there was just this deafening boom. My leg was gone. It had been severed. But from this moment, I have a choice. We have a choice with everything. Not to let losing a leg stop me from doing anything that I wanted to do. As a young girl, I had dreamed of going to the Olympics as a gymnast. I had a second chance. Not only that, but I could represent the country in that Team USA uniform. And I can represent a country that I had defended over in Iraq.
Her speech was just so inspiring, just to know that the idea of focusing on what you have instead of what you don't have is just an amazing message.
Her book and her story of the power of choice really moved me. And for all of us, it's very inspirational.
So I decided I was gonna give it a shot in the sport of swimming. I broke American records I didn't even know existed. And it punched my ticket to go to Beijing.
What an eye-opener. How amazing is this young lady, what she went through.
She exemplified resilience and inspired me. And I think every single person in that room, her story is extraordinary.
I was doing this for those that no longer could. And I can honestly tell all of you that I have done more in my life with one leg than I ever would have done with two.
Now, before we send you off for the final day, we have a very special guest with us today, and I am truly, truly honored to welcome her to the stage. So let me share her bio with you. So I don't want to give away too much of her story here, but here's what I'm going to share about this young woman. She chose to serve our country as a very proud member of the U.S. Army, where she nearly made the ultimate sacrifice. She was the first woman to lose a limb in active duty in the war in Iraq. And for her services to our country, she was awarded the Bronze Star and Purple Heart. Since then, she has turned herself into a world champion athlete. In fact, a three-time world champion who once again proudly represented her country, this time as a member of Team USA at the Paralympic Games in 2008, 2016, and again in 2021. She is the co-founder of the nonprofit sport group Dare to Try, through which she has helped hundreds of other people living with disabilities not only return to sport, but more importantly, build confidence, self-esteem, and a renewed passion for life. She is a proud mother of two young children, her son Dallas and her daughter Millie. She is a patriot in the truest sense of the word. Here's a quick video before we welcome her to the stage.
Morning, we're introducing you to an Army officer turned Paralympian in 2004. Melissa Stockwell became the first female American soldier to lose a limb in the Iraq War.
I lost my leg serving my country. Now I serve in a new uniform. I think grit is getting through things that you never expect. These obstacles that come your way, but finding a way to persevere through them. Having the heart to accept it, to move on. Instead of finding the things that went wrong, you find the things that went right. Where did it bring me? Well, it's brought me here. You have to believe that the training you have put in is gonna create the outcome that you want. Tomorrow is race day. I'm at a loss for words. We're here. Everyone that's here is just so amazing, and I wish my family would be in those stands, but I know that they're cheering at home. I'm just so honored to race on this race course tomorrow, and I'll just give it all I got. All right, go USA.
Please give a warm welcome to Melissa Stockwell.
Good morning, Motorola. Woo! I'm so honored that you guys have chosen to get up out of your warm beds this morning and spend it here with me. And today is it's a little bit of a special day for myself. Every day should be a special day. And in a second, I'm going to share with you why. But first, you just heard a little bit about my story. And what I'm going to do today to all of you is share with you a little bit more. And the hope is that when you leave here, when you leave the room, you go to your meetings today, and maybe tonight you lay your head on your pillow, so you think about it. You think about what we talked about here. Maybe you apply it to your own lives. And you realize that we all have the power of choice to live the lives that we all want to live. So 19 years ago today, on April 13th of 2004, I woke up that morning in Iraq with both of my legs, and I went to sleep that night with just one of them. Definitely not part of my life plan, not on my to-do list for the day. That's funny, I'm supposed to laugh at that. Losing a leg is probably not on anyone's to-do list, but that's kind of the beauty of life. You never really know what life is going to throw at you until it does. I knew that my chosen profession as a military officer had its risks, but you never think that something like this is going to happen to you until it does. And in a moment, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about that story. But first, I want to ask all of you a question. If there was something that came into your own life that was sudden, traumatic, unexpected, how would you handle it? In essence, with COVID, we all have dealt with it, but let's put COVID aside. Do you run from it? Do you run to it? Do you tackle it head on? Maybe you even end up better on the other side. Well, I'm here to tell you that you can do just that. And today I'm going to tell you why. So I like to say that I was born a patriot, a lover of our country from a very young age. I know there are many others out here today who have served, and I thank you for your service. I realized at a young age when I saw that flag, what it meant. And as I grew a little bit older, I saw military personnel. They had flag patches on their shoulder. I would see them around town. I would see them on TV. And I would look at them and realize what they were giving back to a country that I felt so proud to be a part of from a young age. And as I got a little bit older and my parents would say, hey, Melissa, what do you think you want to be when you grow up? I would always say, I wanted to be in the Army. I wanted to wear that uniform and have that flag patch on my shoulder. So my story eventually led me out to the University of Colorado in Boulder, and freshman year, I saw ROTC cadets marching around campus. They had their uniform on, they had that patch on their shoulder, and you could just tell that they were that camaraderie and how much of a team that they were. And I wanted to be a part of that. So sophomore year, I was basically a recruiter's dream. I marched my way into his office. I said, I want to join the Army. What do I do? And he's like, well, first you're going to sign this stack of papers, as he hands me over a stack of papers. I sign my name, hand the papers back to him, and in turn he hands me my very first military uniform, the desert green camouflage that many of you probably think of. I went back to my dorm room, I put that uniform on, and that pride that I felt, just knowing that this is what I was supposed to do with my own life. So I don't come from a military family. My parents knew of my desire to be in the Army, but they kind of thought it was a phase I was passing through. Because to them, like, why would their youngest daughter actually, I mean, join the Army? So imagine their surprise when sophomore year of college, I dial them up and they answer the phone. I'm like, guess what, Mom and Dad? I'm wearing my first uniform. I signed all these papers. I'm gonna be commissioned as an officer and I'm gonna be in the Army. And there's kind of this like awkward pause, as parents do so well. And then my dad, having no idea what to say, blurts out, are you sure they allow girls in the Army? So it was this unknown world that we were all diving into together. But of course they allow girls. And I fell in love with it. I got to wear my uniform. I got to learn battle drills. I got to learn leadership drills. I got to paint my face in mud and roll around in it. I got that camaraderie with my fellow cadets, the physical fitness we had to do. And I loved everything that was a part of it. And then senior year of college came up, and a day came up on the calendar that we'll never forget. September 11th of 2001. If you recall, it was a Tuesday. And like every other Tuesday in college, it was ROTC day, which basically meant I had my uniform on. We were gonna have to do some, we were going to learn about military history and do some battle drill training later that day. But instead, I found myself with my fellow cadets, my fellow classmates, all wearing our uniform, sitting in the classroom as we watched the news unfold on TV as those towers fell. And it was this day that our instructor looked at all of us and he said, today, your lives are going to change. It's not a matter of if you're going to deploy to a war, to a foreign country. It's more a matter of when. So I knew that the uniform that I was so proud to wear on American soil, that I'd probably be wearing it on foreign soil as well. But first, a few months later, I graduated. I was commissioned as a second lieutenant into the United States Army with my once very skeptical but now proud parents by my side. And I set off into the wide world of the Army. So the fateful day of April 13th, 2004, started out just like any other day over in Iraq. I woke up early. I put my uniform on, which included a bulletproof vest, a club Kevlar, my weapon. We had our briefing on the day's mission, on what we were supposed to do that day. And I got into my vehicle, my Humvee. And we had been through missions like this before. The only difference on this specific day is that I didn't really have much of a job. I was doing what was called a ride-along, which meant I was in the Humvee, I was just learning the route because the next day I was gonna take over for that route. And you can see the vehicle here. It was early on in the war. We didn't have armor, we didn't have doors on a lot of our vehicles, but we had a job to do, and we did that job regardless of what we had. So on this day, our vehicle left the gate as we had done every day in the weeks prior, driving down kind of these central Baghdad roads. About 10 minutes into the ride, there was this underpass, kind of like a bridge that you would go up under without even thinking about it. We go under this bridge and there is just this deafening boom. There's black smoke, the smell of metal. I look up and the windshield is crashed in. The woman in the front is yelling, IED, IED, we've hit an IED, which we all knew meant a roadside bomb. The vehicle swerved to the left. We ricocheted off of a guardrail. We swerved back to the right, and we ended up ultimately crashing into this woman's house. We had been through situations like this in training. That's what training is for. And the other four soldiers in the vehicle did exactly what they were supposed to do. They got out of the vehicle, they surrounded it, they pointed their weapons out to assess the situation to see what they should do next. So I started to do just that. I took my seatbelt off, I looked over, I looked down, and I knew something was wrong. There was a lot of blood. And I called out, "I'm hurt, I'm hurt." Lucky for me, there was a combat medic trained in field first aid a few vehicles back, and he heard me. He rushed up to the vehicle, he pulled me out of it, and he laid me there on the sands of Iraq. I was on my back, and at the time, I had no idea really what was happening. I was very much still awake, but there seemed to be so much commotion going on, and I couldn't figure out why. I know now that my leg was gone. It had been severed. So you can imagine the amount of blood being lost and why there was so much commotion. But nobody told me my leg was gone. I'm laying on my back so I can't see what's happening. And it wasn't until the medic, who I thought was just kind of giving me first aid, put a tourniquet on, that I realized that it's probably not as good as I thought. Because we all knew that whatever is below a tourniquet is probably no longer. And then a few days later, seeing this picture from my hospital bed, and the realization that that was my vehicle, that was my blood. There's an orange Gatorade bottle that I remember being so focused on at the time, and a picture 19 years ago today, and a picture that was once really hard to look at. But I can look at this picture now and think about how far I've come, the power of the human spirit. But it was hard to believe that from this moment, just 1 year earlier, I was at my very first duty assignment, a brand new second lieutenant, Fort Hood, Texas, part of the 1st Cavalry Division, and thrown into these roles of being put in charge of soldiers, some that were older than I was, being put in charge of millions of dollars worth of equipment as part of the transportation corps. A daunting challenge, but one that I was ready and happy to take on. And then a few months later, orders came down that the 1st Cavalry Division, so my unit, was gonna be deploying in early 2004. So our desert, or our green uniforms quickly transitioned to the desert color. Our vehicles went from green to the sand color. And in early March of 2004, I boarded a plane and set off to the Middle East, where I was gonna be for the next year. And it's a surreal moment because you're on this plane, you have all your soldiers, your equipment on, and then you land, we landed in Kuwait, and you step off of that plane. The weight of your equipment and the heat and the magnitude of the moment hits you. You drive down these barren desert roads, you look across in the distance and you see these little huts and realize that they are people's homes. And just how different the day-to-day life is over there. Spending a few weeks in Kuwait before making that long road trip from Kuwait up into Iraq, and you cross that border, and your heart starts to beat a little bit faster. You get to the bustling city of Baghdad, and there's just people everywhere, and you just have no idea, do they want you there, do they not, or just what is your day-to-day life gonna be like? But eventually, getting to the town of Taji, is what the town was called, where I settled into what was gonna be my new normal for the next year. I had two jobs over in Iraq, and the first was my favorite, because I got to be in charge of 20 men and women as a platoon leader. A lot of these soldiers, 18 years old, just out of high school, trying to find their way in the world, and they find themselves with me as their leader, in this faraway land, but you become family, that camaraderie just stronger than ever. My other job was as a convoy commander. So basically I'd be in charge of leading a whole bunch of vehicles from one point to the next, delivering various supplies. And as a commander, you're in charge of the soldiers, the route, the equipment, just kind of making sure everything goes as planned. We had been in Iraq for only 3 weeks, but I was a proud soldier. I was leading soldiers. I was carrying out missions. But you just never think that a roadside bomb is going to come across your vehicle, because things like that you always think are just going to happen to somebody else. But this time, it was me. And I was lifted from the sands of Kuwait or Iraq, put in the back of this big kind of 5-ton pickup truck, driven to the nearest aid station, where I was put on a helicopter and flown to the nearest American hospital, which happened to be right in central Baghdad. I was taken off that helicopter, rushed in a stretcher, and someone called out, "You're safe, you're safe, you're in an American hospital." And I was rushed into what I was told was a life-saving surgery. I was told there was a lot of blood being lost. And it wasn't until I woke up from that surgery, I looked to the gentleman next to me and I said, "Did something happen to my leg?" I still had no idea it was gone. And that's when the surgeon, in his very blunt military way, said, it's gone. You don't have it anymore. And all these years later, I feel like what I should have said was, "Well, can you look again?" Because it seemed like surreal that in a second, an entire leg is gone. But instead, he handed me a phone and said, "Would you like to call your parents?" And dialing up my parents' number, my mom answers all excitedly. She hasn't heard from me in a few days, and I have to stop her pretty quickly. Say, "Mom, something bad happened." And that's when the surgeon took the phone to explain to my mother that I no longer had a leg. And hearing the anguish of a mother through the other end of a line is something that never gets old. You never forget that. But from this moment, I had a choice. We have a choice with everything. And I had to move on. So first I had to move on physically. So I left that Baghdad emergency room. I flew to Landstuhl, Germany, which is where all the wounded soldiers kind of stopped on their way back home. And it just so happened that my dad was on business in Vienna. My sister lived over in Europe. So the day after this life-changing injury, I had two immediate family members rush into my hospital room to be by my side. Talk about starting things off right, literally on the right foot. That's all I had left. That's funny also. So spending a few days in Germany in that hospital before making the long trip back to the U.S., back home, this time to Walter Reed Army Medical Center. And it was here where my mom met us. And my parents, once skeptical of their youngest daughter going into the military, and then proud, then having the horror of that phone call, but now strong and steadfast, by my side, often reassuring each other that things were going to be okay. And when I was able to kind of get off the medication, hey, the pain meds a little bit, and come out of my hospital room at Walter Reed, I looked around and I saw soldiers that were missing 2, 3, 4 limbs. They had lost their eyesight. They had traumatic brain injuries. And I looked at myself and I thought, wow, I'm the lucky one. One leg, that was it. Not to mention my life, because too many have given and continue to give that ultimate sacrifice. And making a promise then to live my life for those who had given that sacrifice. Not to let losing a leg stop me from doing anything that I wanted to do. And I did receive a Purple Heart, a Bronze Star, medals that you never expect to get, but ones that are proudly displayed in my home. But what made my time even better were the friends and family that dropped everything they were doing to come to my bedside and let me know that they were there for me, regardless of what was going on in their own lives. But you can imagine it's tough, right? I was 24 years old, and in a second, my life has changed forever. So laying there in my hospital bed, wondering what my life would be like. Would I ever walk? Would I run? Would I live an independent life? But lucky for me, at Walter Reed, they did whatever they could do to kind of help us pass the time. There were always activities, there were things we could do to try to just, you know, instead of just sitting there and thinking about everything. And we would have a lot of visitors. So we would always have some, whether it was, you know, politicians, celebrities, high-ranking military officers kind of come and say their thanks. And I'd like to share my two favorites because they still stand out to me today. So I've been at Walter Reed for a few weeks, and one morning my nurse comes in and she's all excited and she's like, guess who's coming today? And a few hours later, who walks in my room but Tom Hanks. Super genuine and kind. He sits down, we have this great conversation. We talk about that volleyball Wilson from that movie Castaway. And I'm just, you know, on top of the world. And then a few days later, who walks in my room but the Osbournes. So Ozzy and Sharon Osbourne, Ozzy walks around the room. There's a stack of chairs. He's like trying to scale. Sharon sits down on the bed. We try to small talk. I have no idea how to talk to Sharon Osbourne. They're a little bit blurry, kind of like the picture. But I will forever be grateful of anyone that came to the hospital and took time out of their busy life to let us know that what we had done mattered. I also learned at Walter Reed that, as silly as it may sound, it's okay to celebrate the loss of a leg. A lot of soldiers have what's called their alive days. Today, it's my alive day. Instead of mourning what we've lost on the day that our injury happened every year, April 13th, we celebrate what we still have. So often, we're so ingrained to think about the things that can go wrong in our lives. You lay down in bed at night and you think about the things that maybe didn't go as you wanted that day. But there was so much good also. So taking a day today to think about just life and how lucky we are to live the lives that we do. And I decided to take this one step further, and I named what's left of my leg, little leg. It's a leg that's little, it made sense. And decided that every year to celebrate, we were gonna have what was called Little Leg's birthday. This is a picture of my leg with a hat on it that says life is good. When I go back home next week, we're gonna celebrate Little Leg's 19th birthday. But it's a day that's become more than my own birthday. It's a day where we celebrate life, and again, just how lucky we are to live it. But as great as celebrating Little Leg's birthday is, as great as, you know, these celebrities I got to meet at the hospital, what I really wanted to do back at Walter Reed was to get my life back. So down in physical therapy, regaining the strength I had lost after laying in that hospital bed for so long. And then the day came where I was fit for my very first prosthetic leg in this series of castings and measurements. They kind of do all this, and then a few days later, they bring you to the parallel bars. They hand you this piece of plastic and metal, and they're like, now this is your leg, and you're gonna walk with this. And I remember thinking, this is not my leg, and how am I gonna walk with this thing? I stood up in the parallel bars for the first time on my new leg. I looked across the physical therapy gym and I saw a gentleman missing both of his legs and an arm. And guess what he was doing? He was walking. Perspective is everywhere in life. So I have no excuse. So what do I do? Well, I walk. Starting in the parallel bars and then moving to crutches. And then a few days later, a cane. And then the day came where I realized that my life was gonna go on. I was gonna lead an independent life. The only difference is every day I'd wake up, I'd put my prosthetic leg on, I'd go about my day just like all of you do, and I would take that leg off at night. But as soon as I learned to walk, I wanted more. I'd been an athlete when I was younger, a big gymnast, and I would lay in my hospital bed wondering if I could ever be an athlete again. Could I ever feel the thrill of a finish line, the sweat on my face? So as exciting as learning to walk was, even more exciting is what I like to call the start of Melissa Stockwell 2.0. So at the hospital, there were these organizations, and they would come in, and their missions were to come into the hospital, come into our rooms, get us out, and get us out doing things that we never thought we'd do with both of our legs, much less with one. So I took every opportunity that presented itself. And before I knew it, I was doing the New York City Marathon on a bike that I powered with my arms just months after my injury. But crossing that finish line and realizing that I could still be an athlete. A month later, going out to Vail, Colorado, and after growing up skiing on both of my legs, learning how to ski again on just one leg. On that bunny hill to start, wobbly, falling all over the place. But by the end of that week, all the way up that chairlift, flying down the mountain, the wind in my face, and I had never felt so free. Going back to Walter Reed, thinking, if I can do this, I can do anything. And it came at a pretty great time because someone later that week came to the hospital and put a presentation on about the U.S. Paralympics. And I sat in the conference room as this man with a booming voice said, if you train hard enough and if you dedicate yourself to a sport, then you can compete on the world's biggest athletic stage as somebody with a disability. As a young girl, I had dreamed of going to the Olympics as a gymnast. That never happened. But here I was learning that I had a second chance. Not only that, but I could represent a country in that Team USA uniform, and I could represent a country that I had defended over in Iraq. So a dream was born pretty quickly, and I left that room knowing that somehow, someway, I was gonna be a Paralympian. But first, I was medically retired from the military. I went back to school, this time in the field of prosthetics, so learning how to fit other amputees with artificial limbs, a field of work I didn't even know existed until I needed a leg of my own, but realizing the reward of literally getting somebody back up on their feet and showing them what they could do. But this idea of wanting to be a Paralympian was always in the forefront of my mind. It was 2005. I knew that there was going to be a 2008 Paralympic Games, and I wanted to be there. So I decided I was going to give it a shot in the sport of swimming. If any of you are swimmers out there, you might agree that the water has this like healing effect. I would get in the water and almost forget as though I didn't have a leg. No, I do not swim in circles. It was a little bit of a learning curve where learning how to dive off the blocks, doing the flip turns, but I randomly loved the smell of chlorine, so like it all kind of made sense. And the Paralympics is not like the military. I didn't just get to sign up and become a part of it. I had to beat competitors. I had to make certain times if I wanted to make this Paralympic dream a reality. And my times were way up here, and they had to come way down here if I had any shot of making this Beijing Paralympic Games. So I decided to put everything on hold. I moved out to the Olympic Training Center in Colorado Springs. I swam, I ate, I slept, and I swam, and I swam. My times gradually were coming down, but almost 4 years to the day after losing my leg, there was a Paralympic trials, and this is where I had to showcase what I could do. This is where I had to, beat my competitors and make these times, and I was a total long shot going into this meet. I learned a pretty cool lesson. Hard work, dedication, it pays off. You guys know this. At this Paralympic trials, I took 20 seconds off a 400-meter freestyle. I broke American records I didn't even know existed. I was so far from them. At the end of this meet, my times had put me in the top few of the world, and it punched my ticket to go to Beijing. And when they named that team for Beijing, this whole journey from Baghdad to Beijing came full circle. And to me, it just made sense. So the next stop was Beijing. And if any of you watched the 2008 Olympic Games, you might remember seeing Michael Phelps win 8 gold medals in this structure. It was the water cube, they called it, this state-of-the-art structure that they built just for the Olympic and the Paralympic Games. So I got to watch Michael Phelps on TV win his gold medals. And then a few weeks later, I found myself in that water cube with my coach, talking about how I could perform Could I be on that podium? Maybe I could take another 20 seconds off because that was realistic. But really, wanting to do whatever I could to make my country proud. So over in Beijing, I swam in a few events, some freestyle, some butterfly. And every day I swam, I would use my crutches to come out to the blocks. I would look up into the stands and see my family and friends there with a big flag that said, Little Leg Fan Club. And I knew that whatever happened there, that they were there for me. And I wish I could tell you that I did well athletically, but I did not. At the end of the Paralympic Games, I got a participation medal. I wanted to chuck it out the window at the time because I thought I've come all this way and that's all I got. And I felt like I let everybody down. My family, my friends, my teammates, my coach, my country, because I knew I could have done better for them. But I learned a pretty great lesson. Life is all about lessons. At the end of the Paralympic Games, there is a closing ceremonies, and an athlete is nominated to carry the American flag in to represent all the Team USA athletes, typically reserved for someone that has much more than a participation medal. But when my teammates chose me for this honor, I realized that in life, we all want the medals, right? You want the recognition. You want your hard work to pay off. But sometimes it's not always about the medals. It's about the journey to get someplace. It's about overcoming obstacles that come your way, persevering through them, and realizing the strength that you have within. And carrying this object, this American flag that I'm so passionate about, into a sold-out stadium representing all of Team USA. I think in life you kind of have these moments that you wish you can go back and relive over and over again. And for me, this was one. So how do you beat that? How do you beat carrying the American flag in, competing in the Paralympic Games? Well, I went back home, went back to work, again in the field of prosthetics, and just kind of the joy of walking into a patient's room wearing pants and telling them everything that they were going to be able to do with their own lives. And they look at you, question everything you're saying until I pull up my pant leg and show them that I too am an amputee. And if I can do it, that they can do it too. But once you're an athlete, you're always an athlete. And after Beijing, I was invited to do a triathlon. So a triathlon is where you swim, you bike, and you run, something I used to think only like crazy people did, because you do it at the same time, I mean in the same day, and who actually wants to do that? But always up for a challenge, I decided to give it a shot. So in 2009, I flew to California. I did my very first triathlon. I swam, I biked, I ran, came across that finish line, and I was hooked. The challenge of all three sports, being on the same course as able-bodied athletes, the challenge of the different prosthetic legs I had to wear. So if you're not familiar with triathlon, there is this little spot what's called your transition area. So basically you swim, you come back to your little area, you bike, you come back to your area, and then you run. A typical athlete has, you know, their bike, a set of running shoes, biking shoes, you know, in their little area. And I would have my bike, I would have a biking prosthetic leg, I would have a running prosthetic leg, I would have one biking shoe, one running shoe, and you come into transition and there's literally like legs flying everywhere because you're trying to like get them on and off as quick as you can. But I loved it. I loved the challenge of it. And turns out I wasn't so bad at it. For the next many years, I was able to be part of the para-triathlon national team and compete around the nation, around the world. And coming across that finish line with that flag overhead never gets old. And then wanted to kind of step things up a notch and sign up for the elusive Ironman, which are for those that are a little bit crazy. You swim 2.4 miles, you bike 112, you run a marathon 26.2 miles, all in one day, and you pay to do this thing. And I remember signing up because I didn't want to. It's a physical test, yes, but I wanted to know if I could do it mentally. I wanted to test myself mentally to see if I could get through this an event of that magnitude. And I remember this day, it was in Arizona. It was dark. We got in the water, started to swim. We get on the bike. I'm on the run. It's dark again. It had been well over 12 hours. I'm carrying glow sticks to see where I am going. And I'm wondering what on earth I am doing there. Like, I was in such a bad way. And I remember thinking, like, why am I doing this to myself? And I physically stopped. And I had to ask myself that question. And I realized that I was out there running because I could be. I was doing this for those that no longer could. Using that motivation to get through those last couple miles, get to that finish line, and hear the words that I was an Ironman. And the realization that day that we don't give ourselves enough credit on the things that we can do. If you just get out there and try something, it's amazing what we can accomplish. So it's been a little bit of a wild ride. 19 years today. And I can honestly tell all of you that I have done more in my life with one leg than I ever would have done with two. The opportunities I've had, the people I've met, might sound a little bit crazy, but if I could go back and do it again, I would. And true to word, every year, we celebrate Little Leg's birthday. We may or may not dance on the bar. We may or may not drink out of my prosthetic leg. I believe there's a friend here from high school, Brian, in the audience that has drank out of Little Leg's leg. He can tell you about that later. But using this party as, or this day, as a day to celebrate, and really a day of reflection. Because over the past 19 years, I've had some pretty incredible moments in my life. Been able to share a dance and ride a bike with President Bush at his ranch down in Texas. I got a presidential kiss when I presented him with an American flag that flew over the Olympic Village in Beijing. Been able to share my story with Katie Couric and her viewers on what was apparently Red Dress Day. Been able to give a fist bump to the legendary news anchor, Tom Brokaw. I've been able to stand in a room with, at the time, were all five living presidents and their spouses on a day that wasn't about politics as too much as these days, but it was about bringing both sides together, the opening of a presidential library down in Dallas, Texas, and the honor of being asked to say the Pledge of Allegiance, and going home that evening just exuding patriotism, just really proud of where my story had brought me. Been able to share a laugh with Michelle Obama, most recently present our current president and first lady with some Team USA gear. But out of all of these moments, what I'm most proud of is giving back. So back in Chicago, starting a nonprofit called Dare to Try, where we get athletes with physical disabilities into the sport of triathlon. And we take away all the barriers that they may have, the expensive adaptive equipment, the coaching, the training, sometimes just getting to a race. And our athletes get to that starting line. And oftentimes, that finish line of that race is just the beginning for them. The self-worth they gain, the self-confidence. Our motto is one inspires many, and our athletes inspire both on and off the race course. And then, of course, on the personal side, my husband, Brian, my kids, Dallas and Millie, and the joy of being a parent, the best and hardest job in the world. I'll take all the advice if you have it. But the joy of being a parent or a mom that looks a little bit different. And being able to show my kids firsthand that it doesn't matter what we look like, that we all have something different about us. Mine's a little bit more visible. But you embrace what makes you different. You embrace what makes you unique. And you can still get out there and dream big dreams and live the life that you want to live. So as you can imagine, I've learned a lot along the way. We've all learned a lot in our lives. The first is that life is short, Some of us know that more than others, especially after COVID. The second is, as cliche as it sounds, is that dreams come true. Cliches exist because they're true, right? Because in September of 2016, mine did. I had my son Dallas, and I was able to get back into peak athletic shape and qualify for my second Paralympic Games in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, in the sport of triathlon. Of any day that my race could have taken place over in Rio, the date was September 11th. You can imagine the meaning. Waking up September 11th, 2016, in my hotel room in Rio, putting on that Team USA uniform, and knowing that the race wasn't just for me, but every swim stroke, every bike pedal, every run step were for those who no longer could. Swimming, biking, and running up and down the streets of Copacabana Beach in Rio, coming across the finish line, getting a bronze medal that felt like a personal gold. On a historic day, because my teammates got gold and silver. It was a USA sweep on September 11th. And we stood on that podium and saw not one, not two, but three American flags go up as we heard our national anthem. Standing on that podium, thinking about all those years ago over in Iraq, somebody tried to take my life. They didn't. They took my leg, but they did not take my spirit. My teammate who lost her leg to cancer years prior, she did not let that stop her. Truly showing the world the power of the American spirit and how much ability isn't a disability. And this time, hugging my dad and my husband with tears of joy, just so proud to be in that moment. And the best part about it was going home, putting the medal around my son's neck. And because my son was too young to make the trip to Rio, we did have these jumbo size heads made of him for my family to bob around for that extra motivation. So before I conclude, I wanna stop here and share with you guys, again, a few things that I've learned. And the hope is that you think about these and you apply them to your own life. When you leave today, you think about what we've talked about. The first is the power of a team. You guys are a team. And I've been fortunate to experience teamwork in all aspects of my life. In the military, teamwork resonates in everything that we do. Nothing says that truer than 19 years ago when my soldier and my teammate literally saved my life. When I was on that podium in Rio, it wasn't just me up there. It was my team. It was my family, my friends, everyone that believed in me to get there. Find your people. We need them now more than ever. Those people that you can call when days are tough, because days can be hard. They can also be so good. And finding those people to celebrate with when things are so good. Find people you can trust in. Find people you can rely on, because we are all in this life together. I've also come to realize that we don't give ourselves enough credit on the things that we are capable of doing. If you would have told me 20 years ago, so, hey, Melissa, you are gonna go to a war. You're gonna lose a leg, but guess what? Like, you're gonna be okay. You're gonna become a Paralympian. You're gonna become a mom, have this great family. You're gonna share your story. I would have thought, oh my gosh, like, what are you talking? Like, no way can I ever do that. But here I am doing it. For me, what it took was losing a leg to be that catalyst to kind of find my pocket of potential that I always had. I just had to find it. So the question to all of you guys is, how do you skip the roadside bomb part and find your own potential? Well, you start by believing that you can. When you come up on a situation and you think, oh, there's no way I can do that. Well, turn that around. Actually, I can do blank, and you fill that blank in with whatever your Paralympic moment may be. Get out there, try something new. You never know until you try it. In early 2020, my husband and I wanted to open our own business in Colorado Springs, where I currently live, a prosthetic company where we fit other amputees with artificial limbs. And opening a company is scary. Can you live on it? How's it gonna work? Well, we opened our doors in January of 2020, right before COVID hit. But we made it through. And years later, we are a booming business that is thriving and has helped dozens and dozens and dozens of orthotic and prosthetic patients resume their normal everyday life. So try something new. It might be scary, but that's okay. Try it. So this picture of me was hit my lowest of lows. I was in the Baghdad emergency room. That T on my forehead at the time stood for a tourniquet, a crude yet effective way for if anyone found me on the battlefield to know that I had been severely wounded. 19 years later, when I look at this picture though, I don't see that T standing for tourniquet anymore. To me, that T stands for turning point, because this was the turning point in my life. This was a day I realized that you can't stop the things that happen to you. I couldn't stop the fact that a roadside bomb hit my vehicle. I don't think anybody would have doubted me if I said, oh, woe is me, I lost my leg. But instead, I chose to say, all I lost is one leg. Now let's get back to living. We all have metaphoric roadside bombs that come into our lives. COVID was one of them. Loss of a loved one, divorce, things that we can't often change. But what you can control is how you perceive them. How you wake up every morning, and as hard as it may be, find the good, find that one small thing that can help get you through the day. Because we all have the power of choice to live that positive life. In 2021 were the Tokyo Games. Paralympic Games, it'll be called the COVID Games, no spectators, and it was my third Paralympic Games. The only people in the stands were these three jumbo-sized heads of my family. And I went into these games wanting to be back on that podium like I was in Rio. And you look at these pictures of me coming down the finish line and you think, wow, like, look how happy I am. Like, wow, she must be on the podium. Did she win a medal? Well, in my third Paralympic Games, I got fifth place. 5 weeks before this exact day in Tokyo, I was on a bike ride. I hit a branch, I flew off my bike, hit a tree. And I fractured three vertebrae in my back. The doctors kept telling me it was the best place to break a back, things you never think you're gonna hear someone say. But I didn't need surgery, I just had to rest. Well, rest is the last thing you wanna do 5 weeks before a race you've been training 5 years for. But like everything in life, I had a choice. I hit a tree. I could have been dead. I could have got a head injury. I could have been paralyzed. So like the doctor said, all I broke was my back. And I was still able to be on that starting line and that blue finish line carpet at the Tokyo Paralympic Games, wearing that Team USA kit, that uniform, and choosing to just live in the moment. So often we get so caught up in what happened yesterday, what's gonna happen tomorrow, that we forget to just live in the moment. And coming down that finish line, so proud to be there, knowing that back home, my family and friends were cheering me on, and just thinking about how much had happened to get me to that point. And I can honestly tell you that I was the happiest fifth place finisher in Tokyo. The power of choice has been so applicable in my own life that I wrote a book about it. And the goal is that the reader finishes the book and they think about what they've read. And again, they apply it to their own lives. And they realize that we can't stop the things that happen in our own lives, the obstacles that come our way that we never expect, but they're gonna come whether we want them to or not. But we can choose to persevere through them. We can choose to become better on the other side. Doesn't mean it's not hard, but that doesn't mean that you should run away from something. So the next time something doesn't go your way, which it will, how are you guys gonna react? How are all of you gonna rise up and live the life that you wanna live? My own life, well, I did go back and find that tree that hit me. I did not hit it again because that would have hurt me twice, but I told it who was boss. But continuing to share my story in hopes to inspire others, continuing to be the best mother I can be, and again, I'll take all the advice I can get, and hopefully make it to my fourth Paralympic Games in Paris in 2024. But if any of you would like to follow along with the journey of myself and Little Leg, I promise you it's gonna be a good one. Thank you, guys.
Ladies and gentlemen, another round of applause, please, for that motivational, inspirational talk.